The Small Business Show, episode 173 for Wednesday, May 30th, 2018. And welcome to the Small Business Show here at businessshow.co, the show by, for, and about BFA, small business, here in Durham, New Hampshire. I'm Dave Hamilton.
And in Lafayette, California, I'm Shannon Jean. It's not BFF, it's BFA.
BFA, like by, for, and about. Yeah, that's it.
By, yeah, for, man. And about. That's, yeah, really good. Yeah. How are you doing, sir?
Things are good. It's busy, which I always say, but, you know, it's just crazy. And summer's coming up, which means invariably I've got, you know, family travels and other things that interrupt the schedule. But that's okay. You know, it just, yeah, it adds it. The month of May, even though I had lots going on, it was the first month in a while where I felt like I've had focus time to just really work. And I guess that's true about April too, but May, it really started to pay off. We've put a lot of systems in place, you know.
Nice. That's great.
Yeah. We made actually some pretty significant changes to the way we look at what we do. And I only realized they were significant in retrospect. You know,
so what that's interesting. What prompted you to look at those systems and, you know, how things were working and make changes?
Yeah, part of it was just sort of the organic process of being mindful about what we do, you know. Uh-huh. And then 2017 was kind of a weird year for us. We did some great things, but it also wasn't awesome in terms of like overall cash flow and sales. It wasn't our best year. In fact, it was our worst year in a little while. And so, you know, we were that brought up some awareness of, okay, like we got to make some changes. And we did make some staffing changes and that sort of thing. So I think all of those things combined kind of got us we were in a more goals oriented mindset than I had realized. We had systems in place, but it seemed like we had begun to prioritize goals more than we should have. And we basically just sort of wiped that out of our thinking and really just got into it. Like, okay, we started really focusing on honing our systems, and because we had to, you know, there was, because we had some changes, it was like, all right, it's all about systems now. It's not about like goals. We just got to make sure the ship keeps running and there's these things that other people need to pick up or we need to move around. And because of that, you know, we just focused on that. And so it wasn't so much about, you know, monthly sales goals or even quarterly sales goals and things like that. Obviously we were paying attention to it, in a sense, paying attention to it more than we had in a long time, but not in a, we need to beat records or any of that. It's just like, okay, what's coming in, what's going out. Okay. Very functionally, it's functional awareness as opposed to, you know, just like, you know, ring the bell sales board awareness. And because I was going to say in spite of that, but it's not. It's because of that. May was, and we're not, it's not over, but May is the best month we've had. If I take December's out of it, because December's people always come in and like buy for a full year or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, but if I take December's out of it, May's the best month we've had in 4 years.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
And I, you know, for those of you who haven't heard us talk about it before, when Dave's talking about too much focus on goals versus systems, we're referring to Scott Adams, who, you know, wrote a book called How to Fail at Almost Everything and Still Succeed. And his philosophy is that goals are not the way to drive yourself, your business, or whatever. It's much, much more important to develop systems that you can adjust over time, and you get, you know, success all along the way instead of this carrot out at the end that you don't have any success until you achieve it, you know. So it's,
yeah. And it's interesting because last week I'm always looking at it, but last week was when I realized, oh, wow, like May's going really well. And I realized, oh, okay, well, we beat last May for sure. You know, we beat this. Okay, we're ahead of where we were at, you know, end of May last year by May 15th of this year. Way ahead, actually. And, you know, that's when I started sort of looking. I took, you know, I allowed myself the, you know, kind of the, I don't know, the indiscretion of, you know, allowing myself to look backwards and say, oh, look at this. We beat this and we beat this and that's good. But it's like, we just keep focusing on the future. And I even, you know, told everybody here, it's like, well, it's great that, like, this is cool that we've beat all these things. And I'm going to tell you that we've beat all these things, but, and there is, you know, at any time you beat one goal, there's the next one that you can find.
Of course.
Right.
Of
but, course. And that's important to do, because otherwise you stop,
sure.
You know, and so
that's why the system thing is so great. Cause it keeps, you correct. Just keep the cycle going, and it's not like, oh, now what, you know, we hit the
now
goal.
What? No, right. And so every time we would hit some goal that I found, you know, it was like, okay, well, and then here's the next one. And I did put kind of a middle of last week, you know, as the end of the month is coming, you know, we're a week away. I said, whoa, but so there is this next goal that we could hit that would beat, you know, something that's like a 6-year thing or whatever. Uh-huh. But I said, don't worry about it. Like, if it happens, that's great. But, you know, we are way ahead of where we were no matter what, because we've got the momentum going. And don't rush to get, you know, that order that might come in on June 4th. Don't worry about getting that in on May 31st. Like, don't spend all your time worrying about that if it's going to happen anyway.
Yeah, like, that's right.
It's a matter of a couple days. Just keep the system going. Just feed the system and keep it going. It doesn't matter. You know, the 4 days isn't going to make or break anything. It's a stupid thing to look at a goal that way, right?
You know, and that's right.
Fudge
that's exactly
the numbers,
right.
And it,
no,
like, you know, sometimes for morale's purposes you need that, but we've already been just shattering things, and so it's like, okay, we don't like this. No longer is this relevant from a morale standpoint. Like, it, we've proven that the systems are doing well for us. Just go with the system. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. So no, it's great.
Yeah.
And I think then, you know, we'll put a link in the show notes to for folks to learn a little bit more about this process. But that systems mentality, you know, allows you to really break through what, you know, maybe artificial goals that you've set out there, and to, you know, keep spinning off further success and using the system that you, you know, keep going. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, it is.
I really like it.
I like what you said there about, you know, the systems let you break through. You said break through your own goals that you set, and that's so true. We are the ones that limit our abilities, and goals are the way to do that, right? If you say, I need to hit this thing, and even as lofty as it is, if you hit it, then what?
Yeah, I'll never forget. Yeah, I had a buddy of mine, and his dad was a pretty successful engineer. And I can remember him talking about, you know, I set this goal. I always wanted to have, you know, my life, by the time I retired, I wanted $1 million, you know, in investments or whatever.
Sure.
And I remember him saying, you know, my buddy asking him, he's like, oh, you know, well, did you reach it? And was it great? And he goes, yeah, I did. He goes, but then I realized I should have set it for $2 million.
Yeah.
You know, and so that really drives it home. It's like, wow, if you have the system of, rather than setting a goal, oh, I'm going to put $1 million in the bank by the time I retire or whatever arbitrary date you pick, I'm going to develop a system to build wealth.
Yes.
And then, you know, refining the system over time and taking small successes as they happen really propels you and develops this kind of circular system that really, in the case of wealth things, can kick off lots more wealth than you ever thought that it could. So it's a really great way to do it.
Yep. Yeah.
I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah. It's been really interesting. And again, it only sort of, I just noticed it in retrospect as I was kind of looking, you know, I've got spreadsheets and stuff that I track with our numbers. I was like, wow, okay, huh, that's interesting. But it's easy to get caught up in it, right? We're like,
yeah,
oh, cool, I want to hit this goal. Like, that's cool. And it is nice to have a carrot or something.
Yes.
But it's nice when the carrot, and that's what happened in this case, when the carrot simply appeared, we didn't even know we were chasing it, right?
Oh,
we were
just, yeah, that's good.
We were just, you know, to take the analogy further, we were just, you know, planting the seeds and hoeing the field like we know we're supposed to. And suddenly right. there's the carrot. But the carrot wasn't why we, I mean, yes, it's why we were doing it, but we weren't waiting for the carrot. The carrot was not the thing we were after. It was just like, yeah, just, is this the best system we can?
It's a byproduct.
Yeah, it's a byproduct of doing it right. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think you can have, certainly as you develop these systems for your business, that you can set benchmarks along the way.
Yes.
To, 'cause that's how you're going to kind of test the system to see if it's working or if you need to make some adjustments, you know, here and there to get the result that you're looking for.
Yep. Yeah,
that's really
for
cool.
Sure. Yeah, it's hard. Right. You need those things and call them goals, call them benchmarks, call them whatever. You definitely need, you know, things that, like you said, you can test against the system, but you just want to stay focused on the system. So it was an interesting week for that reason. Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. And I think with employees, especially your contractors, whoever you're using, you know, they're always used to, and I think they have a little weariness about, okay, I got this goal set, but boy, once I get gold, they're just going to set another one that's higher, whether it's a sales, you know, number or whatever. And I talk to folks that, you know, work in corporate sales a lot, and they always hear that. Yeah, you know, I made my numbers this last year, and now this year they increased it by 20% and da 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 da. You know, but if you really use this system concept, you can get rid of that mentality because, you know, you set some benchmarks, but the process is just to keep refining the system and seeing the success that comes, you know, from using it.
Yeah.
Rather than that goal that you're just going to keep, you know, you're just going to keep lifting the carrot higher and higher and higher.
Yeah, that's it. Know? And this is completely my fault for letting this happen, because when we started the business and for a long time, we were very much systems focused. That's it. Like, that's all we cared about. And the money just showed up. I mean, you know, again, we paid attention to the money, but it wasn't about that. And then we lost that focus for a little while. And it's nice to regain that. You know, we lost the focus on systems and really, you know, it wasn't intentional, but in a sense it kind of was. I mean, I saw it happening. It was like, oh, maybe this is a good way to do things. No, it's not. It's not, even though it's the traditional way. Like, that's the problem is, you know, you get somebody that says, oh, no, this is the way it's done. Okay. But no, trust what actually works for you and your business. You know, your business is not that business. So,
That's right. You can test it. And what I love about this is because we didn't have this plan to discuss at all. We have an entirely different topic today. But I think it goes to some of the points we were making last week when we did the, you know, the tools and things we used. And I believe we talked about free time, giving yourself time to think and to, you know, let your mind take it wherever it's going to go. Well, this is just like this conversation is bringing it up and then getting to revisit this, you know, critically important topic and being able to, you know, look at your small business and, okay, what are we doing? We're selling widgets. You know, what do we have? How many we're going to sell? Well, why limit yourself to that? Rather, you know, create that system that just constantly accelerates the sell through of widgets. Or you could do the same with customer service. You know, well, we want to have a return rate of no more than X. Well, rather than just focusing on that, you know, create this system that has, how do we minimize returns or complaints or whatever it is that you're measuring, using that systems process really can pay off. And if you're already using it, we would certainly love to hear about it. Email us at feedback@businessshow.co or talk to us in the small business support group at businessshow.co/Facebook.
Yeah. Great. Yeah, for sure.
Very cool. That's good. So, hey, let's talk about today. I wanted to talk about some data and some stuff. I think everybody's probably been seeing lots of emails in their inbox from companies and news organizations saying, you know, we've updated our privacy policy or this has changed, that kind of stuff. And I would say that most of that is a result of the new the EU General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR. Have you been seeing those emails, Dave?
I think I've gotten one of them. Yes, Shannon. Yeah.
I think so. Everybody who gets a newsletter, who goes on a website and signs up and agrees to take cookies. I mean, my inbox has just been flooded with them. So I thought we would take a few minutes here today and talk about the GDPR and, you know, if it does your small business need to be concerned about it and to be concerned about data security. And I would say, you know, I think you do need to be concerned about it in a number of different ways. And I thought we'd chat about it today.
Sounds like a plan, man. Yeah,
cool.
It's interesting. And, you know, I will remind everyone, most of our listeners are actually here in the U.S., just like Shannon and I are. But not everyone is. And so, you know, the things that we talk about here are certainly going to be from a U.S. business perspective on the GDPR. So, if you've got a different perspective and something that we don't cover here, please, you know, use those links.
Yeah, we'd love to hear from you. I know we had a UK, a listener in the UK point out a few things in the small business support group this week. So, yeah, there's certainly some people listening over there, which is great. But, you know, the GDPR, regardless of the size of your business, if you handle any customer's data of citizens living in the EU, you need to pay attention. There are some limitations for small businesses that have less than 250 employees, but from everything I've read, they can easily make exceptions to that. So when it comes to liability for problems, so I think it's probably less expensive to comply than try to fight something. And it's probably definitely worth spending a little time chatting about.
Yeah. This isn't a good entry point into this. We've by now, if you've got an email account, you've heard about the GDPR, right? And the attempt to comply, I think, like you said, is way easier than waiting until someone sues you. Although I'm not entirely sure, without spending a lot of money on lawyers, and even then, whether any business here can get a firm answer of yes, like we're totally compliant. Or I mean, I guess you could, but it would be
maybe.
Yeah, it would be very ominous to look at and check every box on that list for GDPR. It's like you said, it's about customer data, but it's not just customer data, it's visitor data. If you have a website,
that's correct.
Right. Yep. And so if you keep web logs of these people, that may be considered personally identifiable information, especially if it's related, if somehow you've related it to an email address or something else. Now, you know, if you keep your web logs and you just archive them and gzip them and save them in a folder and never delete them, well, that might create a scenario for you, which starts to get really interesting and questionable, because as part of the GDPR, people, in theory, that are in the EU anyway, are now supposed to be able to come to you and say one of two things. Please tell me and show me all of the information you have on me.
Right.
And then number two, please delete all of the information you have on me. And that gets really difficult if, for example, you know, your WordPress installation lets people sign up. So now when they sign up, you've got an IP address in there and their email. So, okay, this is all personally identifiable. But if your web logs are stored somewhere completely different, have nothing to do with WordPress, but that IP address is there, in theory, you could relate that and say that that's part of their information, but it's not going to be. How are you going to delete that individually? Like,
right.
Starts to get really interesting.
It's burdensome. I mean, it's definitely burdensome. And, you know, I'm not a big fan of, you know, these kind of rules, but I do understand that, especially in the case of like social media and search and some other things that, you know, there's definitely been some pushing of the envelope as far as gathering data and using it for different things. But from a business standpoint, I think small business owners tend to get swept up in a lot of these things, and it can be expensive and maybe more to your point, difficult to know if you are in fact complying with it.
Yeah.
And we'll put a few links in the show notes. Zero.com, X-E-R-O. They have a great article. You know, they're an accounting, you know, package. You can do a software solution. And they had some really good points, I thought, about, you know, basically any, you know, what type of data you're collecting, you need to know why. Do you have a legal reason to collect it? You know, and in the case of like your website's like, hey, we're going to put cookies on your, you know, browser to do X, Y, and Z, or we're going to sign up for this newsletter to do this, or we're going to store your data to be able to ship you a product or provide you a service.
Sure.
You know, that kind of thing. And one of the things that really kind of propped my ears up the most is that, you know, if you're buying or renting lists, you know, like potential customers, leads, you know, we did a lot of that with schools where we were looking to connect with IT department heads.
Yep.
Now, you know, according to the GDPRs, they read, you know, the data controller, which would be the person buying it, you're responsible for you're included in that brush, if you will, and they sweep you up of the person that you're getting that data from. So you're responsible for the conduct of the processor. So small businesses need to ensure that, you know, any contracts you're signing or data that you're buying or renting, does it comply with GDPR if you're doing anything in, you know, with EU customers, for sure.
Wow.
And I can only imagine that something in the US is going to come along like this, right?
I mean, I think yeah, you're right. Someone is going to be the poster child, right? And yep. It's going to be something, I think it's going to be something stupid where it's a website, you know, take Mac Observer, for example. In fact, part of me would love for someone to make TMO the poster child because we get a lot of press out of it. But, you know, someone could come to us and say, okay, I am in the EU, or I am an attorney representing, you know, 100 people in the EU that visited your website, and A, B, C, and D, you didn't do these four things right with the GDPR. So we are suing you for whatever the maximum the law would allow them to sue us for. Now, this starts getting really interesting because we don't have a presence in the EU, right? It's not we're a multinational company that has offices everywhere. Well, but, in that we don't have Nexus there. Right?
Yes, you don't have Nexus, a presence, but you know, that's where it's really sticky. I mean, your website is easily accessible by folks over there.
Right. So, we certainly have customers in the EU, but we have readers in the EU, but we also have customers. Like, we take money from people that contribute for our Mac Geek Gab, our premium memberships for the podcast.
Yeah.
So we definitely have that, but we don't have a presence there in terms of a physical presence. We don't have a corporate infrastructure there. We haven't formed another, you know, a European company or anything. We just have the one here in the US. But they say that we could theoretically be the target of a lawsuit. And this would get very complex because, you know, it's an EU company trying to sue or an EU entity trying to sue a US entity. And, you know, my guess is the Electronic Frontier Foundation, they would certainly be the first phone call I would make if I got that notice.
I would think so.
Yeah.
Yep.
And, you know, do you guys want to be the ones to represent the poster children for this? And my guess is they would say yes. My hope is also they would say yes. But I think there's a reasonable guess that they would want to do that. And then it gets interesting, right? So I think certainly the first time this gets tested is when we will all learn how far we all have to go. You know, those of us that are in sort of this very similar boat. And I think the way to prevent against that, or the way to prevent against it really ruining you, is to do the obvious things. You know, if you run anything, like for us, we run WordPress. So if you update to the latest WordPress that came out last week, there are some GDPR things in it, right? So whatever you're using, your shopping cart, whatever that is, my guess is that those vendors have updated already. So,
but you should check, right?
But
just
check.
To be sure.
And
even your marketplace, if you're a big Amazon seller or eBay seller, ask, you know, what's going on? What are they doing about this to be sure you're in compliance on that marketplace or using whatever software platform?
And they will give you some guidance on that. You know, like when the WordPress update came out last week, you know, I logged into our backend after the update happened and there was a big banner up that said, hey, we've added some things to make it easier for you to be GDPR compliant. But, you know, we can only lead you to water. You have to drink. Yeah. Right. And but they had a guide that they had put together and our shopping cart also had a guide that they had put together. And so I decided, you know, this is as stupid as this is and as ridiculous as it is that somebody in the EU thinks that they can sue me. Maybe they can. And it's probably worth taking an hour out of my day to go and go through all this and check all the boxes. Right. Which is what I did. And so we updated our privacy policy to make sure that I think we have what we need in there. And again, I feel like this, if there are a first round of attacks on this, you know, maybe this is wishful thinking, but I don't think it is. Someone who has done absolutely nothing and says, screw it, you can't get me, is in a worse position than those of us that said, I thought we did everything we were supposed to do. You know, not that I thought I wasn't supposed to speed here or I didn't know the speed limit, officer. That doesn't get you out of a speeding ticket, right? But
sure.
You know, I'm pretty sure we've done all the things we're supposed to do, but I'm also pretty sure we've missed something that we have no idea about.
How could you not? I mean, you know, there's no way you would.
So you do the obvious things. And the reason I would say do the obvious things, not only might it protect you, you know, begging the mercy of the court or whatever entity it is that's coming to, you know, swing their mighty hammer at you, but it also makes you less of a target. Because if somebody goes to your website and you definitely like us, you have EU customers, you have EU visitors, and you don't have a privacy policy. Well, guess what? You just became a real easy target because they can say, yeah, you didn't even try, man.
Right. You know, need to act in good faith.
In good faith. And there it is. Yeah.
And do what you think you need to be done. It's documented. Say, hey, you know, to your point, we've got a privacy policy up there. It is GDPR, you know, PR compliant. And if you search that term up on Google, you'll see a bunch of services and templates out there that you can update your stuff. And you know, you shouldn't have an issue with it. One of the things also that.
And I'm going to let you finish, but in this instance, I think copying one of those templates, if you're not going to like go to an attorney or do anything else, I think copying one of those templates as verbatim as makes sense for your business would be the smart move. Because if someone is fishing around for an easy pick, if they see that you've if they see that you're using the language, say, for example, that WordPress has advised, they're probably going to stay away unless somehow they found that WordPress's language isn't enough and then they can go after everybody. But, you know, if they find this common language, they're just going to move on and find an easier target.
I agree. And I think I'm a big fan of business templates and stuff online as well. Just be sure, you know, when using them for whatever it is, that you do read through them and be sure that you are doing what it says. You know, you may not need to, you know, do some of the things, or it may not apply to your industry, and you don't want someone pointing that out and says, well, your privacy policy says you do this. And you're like, oh, wow, you know, we don't do any of that kind of stuff. And, and one of the other things that really stuck out to me, about it was, you know, in many cases, in a lot of our small businesses, you know, we all use laptops to run things and we take all this data with us, when you're working on, you know, spreadsheets and this and that and customer lists. And, one of the comments that I read in the GDPR was that passwords are not considered a sufficient measure to protect personal data that you've collected. So in order to comply with it, you have to encrypt it. So it's got to be encrypted when you're using it, taking it out. So, I mean, if this is a big part of your business, it's important that you do it the right way.
Huh.
For sure.
I didn't realize that.
That was interesting.
Huh.
Yeah, there's specific wording that says that right there. I was like, wow, that's fascinating.
So one way to potentially sort of avoid that would be to encrypt your hard drives, right?
There you
encrypt
go.
Every hard drive encrypt, that yep. you have. And then that way, you know, you don't have to think, oh, did I encrypt that one file? Doesn't matter. Your drive's encrypted. You're good to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
On the Mac, could you use File Vault?
File Vault too. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's great.
Yep.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's pretty wild. So, you know, we'll put some links.
I think TrueCrypt for Windows, right?
TrueCrypt. Yeah. That sounds about right. Although I don't know anything about Windows, it does sound like it fits the, that's the thing. We'll put a link to the, you know, the GDPR up on the, in the show notes. You can take a look at it. It may not be applicable to you, but I would suggest that, you know, now is a good time to look at the way, what you're doing and how, tight or slack your, you know, treatment of that data is, especially if you manage things that's, you know, personal data and addresses and credit card numbers. And, you know, man, if you have to deal with social security numbers or other tax identification information, it's really important that you have a good policy in place and that you have communicated it to all of your employees. So when the stuff does perhaps eventually hit the fan, you and someone comes in, starts asking questions, every employee can say, oh yeah, we have a data security meeting every 6 months and we've talked about X and we do this and this is the person who's in charge. That's powerful. Again, it shows good faith that you are doing it versus asking, hey, who's in charge of your data collection and, you know, stuff in your place, and, you know, having everybody look at each other like we don't know.
Yeah,
and
that worse, everybody says, oh, our boss told us that was effing stupid and we don't have to deal with
it. Right? Yeah. Yeah. And it doesn't cost you anything to have that discussion and hand out a one pager that says, look, you know, hey, it's our whatever normal meetings that you have or have a special meeting, whatever, and say, hey, get this out. This is what happens if you get a call from a customer that says this, and, you know, this is the response that we make, and this is the person, and it may be you, you know, as the business owner, you need to alert me this way, because reporting, especially with the GDPR, is a really big part of it. You only have 72 hours to report a breach of data. And, you know, we've all heard of these horror stories, these companies that sit on this information for months and months and months and only release it when it's beneficial to them. The fact that the, you know, I'm not going to name any names, but, you know, the credit reporting agencies are famous for that. And so, just have that discussion and be ready for it. Cause like I said, I think there's some definite stuff coming down the pike in the US that'll be very similar to this.
So. Yeah. That's really interesting. Yeah. And of course, while you're doing this and if it does wind up costing you a little bit of certainly time, you can look at the credit reporting agencies and Facebook and Google as the reasons that, and others, I don't just mean to call them out, but they are certainly in the list of companies.
Top three.
created, that were so egregiously violating a moral, ethical standard of care with people's data that this is why the GDPR was created. It was like, okay, fine. You know what? We're just going to codify this. And we do need to codify this. I mean, it's important. I don't think the GDPR is the last that we will see of this. I think other countries will implement similar things. I think the GDPR is actually pretty overreaching in terms of what you might get out of the US government. But I do think there will be some things, right? It's easy for us to look at this and say, oh, we don't need this kind of regulation. We don't need this. By and large, you know, the internet is still the Wild West, right? And I think we can all agree, although we might disagree on the specifics, I think we can all agree that it's good that not only do we have highways, and I'm talking for our cars, but that we have accepted speed limits and rules of the road, and we all stop when we get to stoplights. And like those things really help us have lots more cars on the road. We didn't need stop signs and speed limits when there was one car. Right.
Right.
You know, but we do now. We could dicker over the particulars, but having those accepted rules and practices in place so that when you see that person over there driving a car, you can reasonably expect them to follow the rules that you both in theory know. And that's kind of what's happening here is we're starting to put some structure into this.
Some standards,
some
right?
Some standards. Yeah. And it is happening after the fact, but it's not going to be after the fact when we look back 30 years from now, right? Or 50 years from now. It just feels like it's after the fact right now. These are things that, like, taking care of people's data is an obvious thing to do. It just feels cumbersome because we haven't had to codify how we do that. Like, we all say, oh, yeah, I don't want to share my customers' information. That's their information. Well, okay, we all sort of agree to that. Well, some of us do. But, you know, but not everybody does. And some people have abused that. It's like, okay, well, we all were driving 40 on this road, and that's fine. Yeah, maybe we should have been going 35. But that guy that keeps coming through here going 80, he's the reason that we have to put up speed limit signs and speed bumps. Right. And so here we are, you know. That's the closest analogy I can get to it. So.
No, I would agree. And I think that, you know, generally speaking, this is not something to be overly worried about, but it is something to be prepared for. And it's going to inevitably, you're going to have some customer ask you about, how do you store my data? What happens? So if you're prepared for that, it's just going to help your business, and it will be better business. And in actuality, it can be one more piece of trust that you market to your customers and say, look, we are compliant with this. All your data is encrypted versus the guy down the street that is not paying any attention to this and doesn't really care about where your stuff is stored and what, you know, what's going on. So, you know, you can kind of spin it in a positive light to help build trust with your customers.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So it's cool. It's a little bit of a pain in the neck, but it's worth it.
Yeah. 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 So, you know, I'd love to hear if it's impacting you, whether you're in the US or, you know, the EU. UK is going to implement all this same stuff before Brexit. And so it would be interesting to hear any of those stories. Again, feedback at businessshow.co or businessshow.co/Facebook. Come talk to us in the small business support group. There's about 400 other business owners in there that would like to hear from you.
Absolutely. Fun stuff, man. Yeah, it's been, you know, this is one of the, and this is there's a cautionary tale here, or at least a heads up. We've known about GDPR for 2 years, and yet it's the last 2 weeks where all of us, myself included, I can't speak for everybody, but it certainly seems like I'm not alone, where I just was like, whatever, it's what they're doing over there. It's probably not even going to happen anyway. And suddenly it's like, wait a minute, this is actually, like, maybe we should look at this. Maybe we should think about it. So the next time this kind of thing starts to percolate, you know, like, we could have had this show, this episode, a year ago, and given you all the same information that we gave you just now. But
we
could not have, because I had no idea about it, and I don't think you did either.
No. It just, all this stuff brought us to our attention. I was like, oh, we need to talk about this.
Yeah, so we need to talk about it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah.
So,
well, take it easy, everybody.
Thanks, folks. Have an excellent week, and we'll talk to you next week. And, man, you know, make sure you keep living that charmed life.
Got it.
Businessshow.co. See us there.